See, while the humidity is almost too fierce to film it, you can see it. I'm trying to manage my camera right now. The humidity is ridiculous. You can't even keep it in focus. But just a quick look, you can see that they're spraying the sky like ridiculous right now. They're making use of all the humidity that they trapped last night. And sure enough, that's it right there. So I just wanted to get you before I got out to the farm and show you the mess that's out here in the skies. Give you a heads up and let you know solar radiation management from Harvard's happening. It's no joke, it's no lie. I'm tired of being, being called like a liar, man. I've been showing you all the data on it. There's no lies here. This is what's going on. Solar radiation management is damaging your planet. You should know about it. You should do something about it and talk to somebody. Ask questions, please. Just ask questions. I'll answer all of them calmly, quietly, and I won't overdo it, man. I'll just try to go slow. I'll give you the information you need to look up. You can do your own research. You don't have to trust me. Don't have to trust me. I gotta re-clean the lens here. I'm on my way out to do my 10K walk, and I gotta go walk under all that crap, okay? So this is what I'm gonna be bathed in right now, okay? I'm gonna be bathed in this stuff while I walk out in the outback, you know? But there's no escaping it. You can't even go inside. Look, he was right next to that one. There's one right there doing another one. You can't escape it even inside. There's no filtration you could get. Unless you have nuclear filtration, something that can handle filtering out nuclear particles, you can't filter out nanoparticles with just a HEPA filter. So don't think that you're escaping this by having good filtration or something. It's not gonna happen, folks. This is the most real thing you've ever experienced, and you need to start learning about it because your kids are being affected by this, your families are. The size of that plume behind there is about three times the size of that plane's wingspan, okay? That's a wide plume. That's not just an exhaust plume. That doesn't happen like that. Exhaust doesn't end the exhaust again. It doesn't stay in the air and turn into a cloud. So just so you know, I'm just giving you the quickie before I go out on the farm. It's real. There's no joke here. I'm not making up stuff. Anyway, you see it, it's on and off spraying. It's like there. See how they can turn it on and off? There you go. It's reality, man. And he'll turn it off. He'll turn it on again. Watch here. Might as well get this on footage here. Let me see the lens a little bit. They're capitalizing on all the moisture with a desiccant up there. That desiccant will hold the moisture in place over any place that they need it. And who's they? Geoengineers. David Keith.
We'll look it up. I'm not making this stuff up. Have a good day. Well, not have a good day, but we'll have a good day, but I'll see you at the farm. Peace.
Hey, guys. What's happening? This is Frank out here on the farm, and we are the ranch, not the farm, but the ranch, and we're going to be walking amongst the cows and kind of talking about some stuff that I thought we might try to figure out together. I mean, there's some confusion as to whether or not people are for saving the earth or against saving the earth when they talk about Agenda 21 and sustainability and all this other stuff. What is the deal is the quest today? Is why are some people thinking that, for example, I'm not wanting to help save the earth when I talk about the agenda plans and stuff like that of the UN being bad? Okay, that's kind of like what we're going to discuss today. But welcome to the ranch. Outside the box is another episode of trying to figure stuff out, man. You know, pretty much it. I'm not a TV show. I'm not like a wild host. Just a guy, person out here like everybody else, and just trying to figure it out. I get the benefit of walking out in the ranch. You can see the clouds that they've created, and you'll see it right now. I'm going to be overlaying right there. You'll see that they're spraying the skies over my house this morning before I left. And, you know, the skies fill up, and we get this nasty cloud cover called solar radiation management, which is kind of icky, as you can see. But, of course, you know, it's just the way it goes when you're in a technocratic scientific community society thing. So let's get out there on the farm and do some walking and talking, and we'll figure it all out together. Okay, guys? All right. Thanks for joining me on Outside the Box today. Hey, guys. I just wanted to show an example of how the stuff that's falling out from the solar radiation management affects the trees. Now, we all know that in the sustainability plan and a lot of the studies that so-called studies Harvard and such has been doing, we all know what these studies that have been going on, that trees are actually not good for what they call carbon sequestering. Carbon sequestering for these people is millions and millions and millions and hundreds of millions of dollars. But when you have a tree like this, that you can see the, you want to see what the roots look like. This tree didn't die from drought, and there's plenty of moisture back here. Where are the roots though? You see how the roots are all just disformed and not able to actually, there's a cow right there. They're not able to form, they don't form. And there's a problem with that. This is a wide tree. This root system should have been branched out and really structured really well out in this drier soil, but it never made it. And you see this tree's dead. This is, you know, gonna be firewood for me for camping. Oh, there's a butterfly following me around. It'll be firewood, and that's because the stomata of the tree was clogged by particulates in the air. So, you know, whether it be pollution, whether it be for solar radiation management, whatever you want to call it, it's still particulate in the air that's affecting the trees. That's just a little something I wanted to show you and talk about. If you just, you know, if you search up tree uptake, nanoparticulate uptake of trees, you can probably find some information. If you look up solar radiation management and what they're using in it, you can see why that affects the tree roots. Do the back research for that and you'll find out. But it's all there, black and white. There's no mistake. Here's another tree. The top is green still. See, the top is still green. And tree's practically still alive, but laying down dead. So it's like it's had its legs cut off, you know, and it's just waiting to die as it lays there. This one will be next, and so on down the line until there's no trees, until you have a pasture like this and everything's wiped out. I mean, but grass is good for the carbon sink, people, because what grass does is grass allows the carbon to be taken up on a mass scale with more surface area for the grass. Obviously, there's more surface area, so there's more carbon uptake. That's more money. It turns out, you can look at some Reuters figures, and they've actually quoted some people. They're making hundreds of millions of dollars off of carbon catches, carbon sinks, carbon sequestering. But the output that they're taking in is nothing. Some figures were like, per day, with maybe 45 people's worth of CO2. It's not doing anything except making people richer and causing us to worry about CO2, because they're not shutting down the things causing the CO2. We're not talking about cow farts. We're talking about cars and plants. David Keith even said, you can keep that stuff running. We have ideas. He wants carbon because he wants to make money off it. It's just an easy game. It's like a dentist owning a candy store right next to his practice. Come on, man. That's an easy one. So they create this ability for carbon to be made by leaving cars on the road. They're not going to give you any battery cars. That's not going to happen. George Soros took over the battery car industry. It's a done deal. That the agenda for the future has no cars on the road at all. No cars. You're going to be driving in buses and stuff that are run off of, you know, like trolleys and trams, which is a great idea. Why is all this idea coming so late, though? That's the question you should ask yourself. Why is it coming so late? This air is so polluted and toxic right now. It's hard to even breathe out here. It's so nasty, toxic. But, you know, hey, I don't know. Where was I? Okay, here's another thing you should know about. CO2 causes brain fog. Apparently, as the Harvard scientists will tell you, CO2 causing brain fog sure as hell gets you on board with getting rid of CO2, doesn't it? You don't want brain fog. I don't want my brain affected, so please go ahead and remove it all. I don't want any CO2 because I don't need brain fog. I can barely make it through my dang day as it is, man. I don't need extra brain fog. Come on. Who are we kidding? So, you know, these guys don't get a chance. They're happier that the cows have brain fog because they're easier to catch and round up and pen up. Makes sense, doesn't it? Keep them a little bit undernourished. They can't fight back. Keep them dumbed down. They can't think about anything but trying to get nourished and not be dumbed down. It's a harsh military strategy we're being dealt. It actually is a military strategy to starve and drought people in order to take their land. It's what they call kleptocracy. Kleptocracy, just like kleptomaniac, kleptocracy. That's all it is. There's no creepy Illuminati people behind some kind of mask doing ghoulish ceremonies and stuff. Or maybe there is, but they don't have anything to do with anything. The real ghoulish ceremonies are the fact that we go and vote for somebody that we think is going to do something. These politicians are just an act, a show. They're getting stupid things done for the bigger agenda. For example, somebody was just telling me that they were watching news all weekend and seeing that it was a full orchestration. It's like a soap opera. And I said, well, what did the final outcome result as from all of that soap opera? All of the nonsense, what did it amount to? She said, nothing. I said, exactly. I said, but actually it did push part of the agenda. That's to make the last remaining few people still watching the news realize that this government system is bullshit and that the new Oprah Winfrey system comes in, the socialism nonsense, which isn't total nonsense, but the way that they want to do it is old communist style. It's not like socialism where we benefit. It's not Marxist. It's Leninism. So, you know, I mean, you got to go back and read a little bit about this stuff. It's so important to read. I just went down a hole. You gotta read. We don't read stuff, especially, you gotta be careful because the book burning thing is real. They get rid of all the data on YouTube. They change it every day. I've watched music videos that have been cleaned up and updated that you wouldn't notice they've been changed, but of course they have been. I can tell because I've seen them 8,000 times. And I've probably ripped the thing to make a lyric video out of it. So I've seen it so clearly, I could see that let's say they've made it better. They wanted to get it out early for the album release, and then they went back and cleaned up the video. You know, they're after the fact. Kind of like the moon landing. Oh yeah, we're here, we're on the moon. Hi, how you doing? They went back a few years later, but I think the whole first one, they just rushed and faked like a whole thing. So, you know how everybody thinks it's a fake landing? I'm pretty sure people went to the freaking moon because we have like moon bases up there. We have moon bases there. But the first one was probably a political stunt just to get everybody, you know, we're beating Russia, we're winning, because they were actually in space first. So I think the whole thing is just political poo-poo. For example, Rick Scott and Red Tide. Rick Scott has nothing to do with the Red Tide. Ocean iron fertilization has a lot to do with Red Tide. Don't see that commercial, but you see the Rick Scott commercial. You know, there, I don't know how much. Everything has been placed there for you, like ready-made news, ready-made stories, ready-made drama, ready-made Inquirer-type bullshit, ready-made by these people who know that you're going to be eating it up. Man, it's a rough world. I don't get paid by anybody to do this. I do this for my own self to get the information, and I hope somebody's listening and just... just trying to understand. I mean, it's hard for me to walk and talk and keep up with what I'm saying, like if nobody's answering me to say, oh yeah, I get it. So I may ramble a little bit. Boy, it's hard to breathe out here. But the point I'm trying to make is the whole game, I shouldn't get too close to these bushes because anywhere in there could be rattlesnakes or anything else ready to jump out at me. Like right here, you see? Just heard something. Isn't that creepy? I want to go in there. I bet you're cats in there. I thought it was a big cat. I've had four and a half wild panther experiences out here. Each one has been more epic than the last. So. Hey, look, I found one of my walking sticks. That's a cool thing to find. And luckily it's collapsible, so I can put it in my backpack. But yeah, so I'm out here today and just going to... I'm gonna lock up my stuff and my bag, get to a new spot, and we'll talk some more, okay? See you in that fast. turns out that we're all just data as we move along and as we react. Like all these cows just reacted to my presence here. They all just, some of them come running, some of them go fleeing. They all react differently to me. Some of them get used to people. Sorry, I'm touching the microphone wires here. Some of them get used to people, some of them aren't used to people, you know. There's, they all react differently. But what happens is, if you're a farmer, and you need to herd these cattle up, which I hate even talking like that, because it's not something I don't approve of farming of life. I just, you know, it's one thing if you're a hunter, I just don't approve of this whole complication of farming, because you make the animals trust you, then you kill them. It's just not right. That's crazy shit, dude. You know, it's, obviously it's an old school humanity thing that we've always been accustomed to, but we don't still stone people, do we? We don't still, you know, burn witches at stakes. Come on. Some things you can let go. Anyway. The idea is that we are a mammalian data machine. We're mammalian computers. We offer up so much data in responses to stuff. The responses we give to whatever happens on the news, the responses, "Hi, sweetheart, how are you?" The responses we give to people when they say hello to us, the responses we give in life, really, it's data to the other receiver. So you transmit and you receive data all day. That's communication in a sense. So literally, computer communication and human communication are almost identical in a lot of ways, because the human brain created the computer to think like it, but better. Okay? Why transhumanism sucks, because you know what, they try to push all this shit. Oh yeah, you'll do better with a chip. I was doing fine before. And I didn't need your chip. I'm doing okay on my own. Thank you. Whatever. So the point is, if you weren't being affected by so much experimentation, you really would have no use in this world, because all they want from us is to find out what's working and what's not working, so they can continue a cycle of society planning. We have society engineers as well as geoengineers and weather engineers. We have society engineers. Behaviorists. When I was taking my first years of college, I was in studying to be a teacher and a psychiatrist. I wanted to be a shrink. I figured it would be an easy job to listen to people's troubles. As I was growing up, kids come up to me and always ask me how to work shit. You know? I was always like their shrink. You know? Then I became a bartender and I became a well-paid shrink. And then now I'm just offering any kind of insight I can. But our behavioral patterns have been programmed to respond a certain way to certain things. For example, I just talked and spit and a little leak came out. If I was in a conversation, there are people who would have dodged it. If it was, let's say, somebody who had a crush on me, they might have tried to catch it. So there's responses trained by your ability to perceive something like that. My response was, I hear a rattle in a bush, I move away from it. You know, this isn't a movie, I'm not gonna stand still next to the rattlesnake. I'm moving away from the rattlesnake. I've seen rattlesnakes out here the size of my leg. No joke. No, literally the size of my ankle. That's how thick it was. It was monstrous. Never seen a Eastern diamond that big. Monstrous snake. I hope the audio is okay. I'm using a pair of headphones as a microphone. I'm gonna go to my site. This is where I camp, over here by these cows have taken up hostel in my in the camp area, but it's okay. I don't mind sharing it with them. It's their home first. You know. But anyway, we react to stuff. They shoot a chemtrail over my head, I post it. I react, I give them data, because you guys either react or don't react, and that gives them data, and it's all data game. We've literally turned into the summations, you know, like zeros and ones, as Trent said, zero sum, the song from Nine Inch Nails. Zero sum economics is a real thing, and it's not just a song. But, so yeah, I'm just trying to understand that we're being used as a complete data source for all kinds of crazy shit that goes on in the world, okay? And I don't know if that's fair. Do you think that's fair? Who's using this data? People at the UN. They're think tanks. There are think tanks attached to so many different corporations that what happens in a think tank is people roundtable ideas, shit like we're doing right now. We just bounce ideas off. If I had you in front of me, we could bounce these ideas off each other and learn from them. Make sure I'm recording. And I have 20, good. See, when I try to videotape in high depth, I still call it videotape, when I record in high depth, it uses more space on the chip. So I can't get all the nature I want to get in for you as much as I'd like. Look, wild chives. Really good. Wild chives. Hi, buddy. Get some shade. Isn't that cool? Anyway, so... Here. You see how far we've come? All the way from across that field. Let me look through the lens here. I'll show you. See, if you came from all the way there somewhere. Let me zoom out and you can see. Just forever away. Anyway, that's, I try to do the longest walk I can out here and do the most... It's pretty tough conditions. It's not the worst conditions ever, but I've been out here where it's been like 2 feet of water the whole way. And me and Logan have been out here and gotten trapped in some hairy spots and almost got eaten by snakes and stuff. So it's been exciting. This is a fun place for us. We enjoy it. I'm very thankful to be able to come out to nature before it's all gone. I don't mean gone just because they're destroying it, but gone because, hey, please don't attack me. pretty much because it's going to be turned into full preserve lands and stuff and carbon capture zones because of all the grassland. They're going to utilize it. They give you the big scare. The world's coming to an end. We've got to take, you know, the whole commandeer your vehicle thing. You know, on TV, cop goes up to the car, he's like, I'm going to take this vehicle, police officer, and the guy just like, no, you're not. Anyway, that's the whole trick, is that to commandeer the land, they've got to create a problem that causes that to be necessary. Because the problems that we have now are not that dire without any intrusion from this factory industry corporate nonsense. We, as a whole, we wouldn't be able to have the cars if they didn't make them for us, true. But why do we have to have cars that pollute? Why couldn't they initially been on the Tesla designs? Why did they do all the things to Tesla that they did? So many whys, you know why. I heard it said on Hogan's Heroes in the spy game that he doesn't, they don't really care much for people who die, they just care about money. And that's really what it is, it's all technocratic nonsense. 1930s, technocrats started to popularize themselves. Oh my God, I'm in a bad spot here. This is not good. I need to be lying in this stuff. It's kind of scary, I'm on some high ground right here. I need to figure out where to go. You see what happens? You get trapped, painted into corners, and there's alligators and all kinds of critters here that I don't want to be in contact with very often. And this is getting a little bit hairy. See, I'd like to cross this ravine right here, but it's pretty much about 3 feet deep, and there could be anything in there that I don't want to be in contact with. And the minute I put my pole in the water to leap across it, it might bite me. So we try to avoid that. Let me get back on dry ground. It's tough to walk and talk and hold a camera and all this. I mean, I don't know how Bear Grylls does it. Just he has a cameraman. I'm gonna try to cross this ravine. I gotta jump it. Okay, you ready? We're gonna leave for our lives here. Made it. Cool. Hey. All right, I'm gonna take a breather on talking because I'm starting to lose my breath. I'll get back to the top. I mean, you can see right before your eyes there's trailing being made behind all this crap up there. So anyway, they sequester all that moisture. I managed to catch my breath a little here. Got into some drier ground, and I'm at the fence line. I brought that up in a video before. When you see a fence line out in this vast field like this, it's kind of a friendly sight because at least it gives you some direction to go in. And it seems that our fences save us at times, right? It seems logical that if I followed this barbed wire, nasty fence along its path, I'd get somewhere. But it's not always true. I could follow this fence for quite some time. I won't get anywhere. Actually, as a matter of fact, if I follow that fence and don't look around outside the fence, I go in a circle around the entire farm. Over and over and over, go in a circle around the entire farm if I follow a fence. If I follow guideposts along the way, it could be misleading. So I ignore them, and I follow this concrete thing right here, this fence. But on my way, as I'm following this thing, this menace, this thing that cuts up our planet into sections, compartments, as I follow it, I'm looking around, and I'm realizing there's more to this field than what's behind that wire. And because that wire is so, frightening, people tend to not want to go near it. They want to stay clear of it. They want to have nothing to do with that aspect of it all. They want to stay within the pen. But then there are some of us who see that fence and say, hey, I figured out a way out of this. I figured out a way out of this maze, this box in here, this trap. I could get on this fence and just keep going. I can't go through it yet because it's too frightening still. So I'm gonna keep going around and I'll find an opening. There'll be an opening somewhere. I know it. There has to be. There has to be an opening because we got in here somehow. But that's the trick, is that we got in here, but not alone. We were aided and guided into here. And by that means, someone closed the gate behind us, locked the door. And the guide signs, the guideposts that are there are also meant to keep a circular path happening. Never a straight line in any direction, always a circular path. If you notice the cycles of life, life doesn't necessarily move in cycles. There are cycles that happen within the plane of existence, but it is a straight line. It's an outward journey from a center point. Maybe some spiraling going on, but it sure as hell isn't a circle in any means. The circle is the illusion. The trapped inside of a circle is an illusion, but it's a good one. One that's so good that people are afraid to find out if there's something outside the circle. I'll give you a perfect example of this. I've had people say to me they'd rather pay taxes because they trust the fact that those taxes will help the right people. When you, I mean, you can show them the figures that they all go to weapons, that we spend more money on machine guns and stuff than we do in the top eight, the largest eight militaries in the world combined. So our tax dollars are not going towards things that are important. They're going towards menacing things. But those people have such a fear of even those words. It's like barbed wire, the words to say, oh, this is bad, this person's doing bad, or this priest is not so honest, or this religion isn't so copacetic. Maybe scientific, what do you call their, Scientology people, maybe they're not so such good people after all. Oh, but nobody sees, the thing is, we've been trained to fear words, that they were going to summon up some kind of demons, like spelling, where spelling is the act of spelling, putting a spell, using words to cast some kind of suggestion. You know, you're casting an idea out into the world. It's called a spell, and you spell things. You know, we're locked into a vocabulary which panics us. We're afraid of our words. I know people who are afraid, Roman Catholics, including myself. I was terrified of uttering a thought that would maybe think outside of the box with God. It was always exactly what the Roman Catholics taught me, and if I thought anything else, I would burn right there on the spot, go to hell, and fry. And did that happen? No. I'm not fried. I'm not in hell. I'm actually well beyond hell into a beautiful place of understanding and truth. The hell for me was not knowing what was going on. That was hell. The hell was somebody made me think it was my fault that I was a failure in this world, somehow a failure. Like I didn't succeed up to a par, up to somebody's set benchmark. The benchmark right there. You know what? I went past that benchmark. But what society has in store for people who go past the benchmark is no re-entry. And it'll have the people who are so happy being inside the box, no matter what is being laid on them from above, even it could be fairy dust to toxic shit. They don't care. They just want to get through it all with their head down. And I understand that. It's okay. That's called fear. We're all afraid. I'm afraid. I'm not a superhero. I'm afraid of this shit over my head here. You see that spray line? I'm afraid of that shit. I'm afraid of, not that that's going to hurt me, but I'm afraid of what it shows me in humans. I'm afraid of that part, the part that it shows me, the part that, oh, well, some people actually don't care. Some people actually don't even want to do the research to find out if it's good or bad. Some people don't even, the CO2 thing, it almost makes me wonder if people aren't just under like a drug and they're not paying attention. I have teachers, educated people who won't pay attention. Oh, it's so sad. I was a marine biologist for Moat Marine Lab. I've done so many different things in my lifetime. Science teacher back home. I understand science. I'm not going to bore you with all the technology and terminology. I'm trying to get a different perspective that you can look at and try to understand that this Q shit was all fake, meant to confuse everybody. Quinn Michaels is the guy who invented it. He admits it. He meant to use it to make people confused. And Q worked off of Twitter posts, so all the Twitter posts and Facebook posts would all be eaten up by a bot and then regurgitated in some new format. And all just to make you fucking confused. What kind of a monster is that, man? People are committing suicide because they think the Earth is dead. And the Earth is dying. Don't get me wrong. All the shit we do, yeah, it's bad. But we didn't have a choice because they didn't give us one. They gave us very few choices. I'm sorry, I get very upset about this. We've had very few choices. We haven't had the benefit of our own free will. Bertrand Russell said about, I can't even remember, but what he said was sociology was about controlling people, and really it is. It's not about a society of freedom, it's about a society of indoctrinated control. I'll post a quote right over the spot that I'm talking right now so you can read it, but of course I'm brain fogged from all this crap. Literally, I can actually feel some days worse than others where you can't really think at all. I mean, and I know a lot of people talk about that. Did I just divulge data for the big heads? Sure I did. I don't care. Some of you need to know. We all need to know this stuff. So if we have to divulge data and we have to become data in the process, so be it. I've got to get truth out to you. I can't keep it hidden. I can't keep it inside of me. This is too big and too important right now. Agenda 21 is a bad thing. It's about full UN control of all your resources as if they don't have them now. But you see how well it's going right now? It's not going so well. They already have control. All Agenda 21 is to push further into you and I, into our freedom, push further and take more. But also what will happen is with that new policy, you'll accept it. That's what the idea is. It's not about, they don't want to be looked at as takeover people. They want to be looked at as helpers. And they're lying sacks of shit. Because they don't tell you about this. But they're doing it. They're doing it. They don't tell you. They don't want to tell you. No, because they know that many people don't want to know. Inside this box, they don't want to know. That's why the show's outside the box. That television, that evil, I don't want to say evil, because I don't like that word, because that implies religion. That TV is one of the most effective tools for opinion swaying in the world ever created. So you that's why outside the box is what it is. It's these beautiful flowers. There's so much beauty in this world. If people would just allow it to grow and be and just have a way about it. I'm going to go to a different spot. I got 5 more minutes. I'm going to cap this off after I clear my head a little bit. I get too wound up out here. I'll see you in a minute, guys. See, literally as we speak, right over my head, literally as we are sitting here talking about it, you're seeing these little shots of it to create these little cumulus cloud formations, less observable to the public. People don't see it. They see cumulus clouds. They don't know that that's going to stay and turn into a cloud. Look, here's one right here that's turning into a cloud already. See? They don't go away. Let me try to work the exposure a little. They don't go away. See it? Watch. I'll back out to this one with the exposure down. There, see? Clear as day, folks. I'm not trying to lie to you. I'm not trying to make you scared. I'm not trying to like create some kind of new creation of crazy here, but this is some bad crap they're doing, man. Bad crap. Look at that. Come on. I'm under this right now. All these cows are all freezing this crap. I mean, it actually makes me a freaking afraid. I mean, look at that, dude. That's not normal. It's actually, because you know you're out here on this fucking plane, it's scary. That's scary. It's scary.
You don't think that's... I mean, come on. I'd be out on a big grassy plane and look at all that ant behind me, and it's like, I'll pan slowly. It's like this. It's just kind of like, you know, post-apocalyptic nonsense, man.
Well, I'd like to close today's talk with this, guys. First off, thank you for listening. Thank you for taking some time to, you know, I mean, we get this 1 minute schedule thing, like I can't listen for more than 1 minute or else I might miss another post or something. I don't know what it is that we've been trained so well to just have that microwave minute mindset. Call it, and it's like, you know, you're waiting for your baked potato and a minute is too long. Remember, we had to bake potatoes in the oven. That was a long time ago, but we had to do that anyway. The trick is, this is a situation where you're damned if you do, if you're damned if you don't. Like, if you want trees, they're actually going to be taken out because they want to put grass in for another reason. I mean, there's so many little facets going on. I give you guys a good thing to do. If you want to get into this and understand a little deeper, is look up Council of Foreign Relations, CFR. Look up think tanks for the UN. Just look up think tanks and foundations, UN, United Nations, think tank. You know, search it like that. Think tanks, comma, UN. You know what I mean? Something like that. And do a search on that and get yourself up to date on what think tanking is all about and lobbying. You know, everybody talks about how lobbying controls politics. That's the tip of the iceberg. The lobbying controls whether or not you approve of this. It'll tell you whether you approve of this by how many special posts it puts out with special interest and millions of likes, so that you like this lining of the sky. You know, it's to change the mindset little by little, as the UN says. There, if you look at the tag little by little on Google, it's the UN's motivation or UN's proposal on how to do this little by little. It's called LIL with an X, LIL, LILXLIL. Hashtag that, little by little, little by little. And you'll see, the UN has such a pretty picture on the fact that they want to take all this land from you. You won't be able to walk on it anymore because it's, you know, it's for your own benefit not to have grass. The farmer here, the rancher won't have his ranch. They're doing away with ranching. They're sending red tide in to get rid of your nuclear plants. They send, the red tide's coming from ocean iron fertilization, mostly. It's coming from a lot of things. Heated oceans and gases and all kinds of cool stuff. But it's actually coming, a lot is being fostered by ocean iron fertilization to cool the planet. So how is this helping? If you're gonna kill everything in the ocean which supports the rest of the planet, how is that helping the planet? You see, their crazy ideas are actually more dangerous than anything else. Thank you guys for joining me out here on Outside the Box. Ask me questions, please go ahead in the comments and contact me on Facebook or something. Frank is out. I'm Frank, I'm out. I'll see you guys later. I love you and thank you. And look, you made it this far. You come a long way compared to, you know, people that are still inside this box. You know, we're outside the fence looking in now. Cal agrees. Love you guys. Be well.